Now, is the winter of our discontent made glory... terribly sorry, barred in my throat. Do apologise. Where were we? Oh, yes. Good afternoon, subjects. My name is Richard III, the last of the Plantagenet kings, but I'm sure you know that. Yes, but probably most of the other stuff you know about me comes from fairly dubious sources, so let's put a few things straight. Firstly, no hump, or not so as you'd notice. No limp. And my arm works perfectly well, thank you very much. I was a soldier, a general in my brother Edward IV's army, and I could swing a sword with the best of them. Secondly, I was the rightful king. When my brother Edward died, his sons, the princes Edward and Richard, were both much too young to ascend to the throne, and so I took over as protector. And then it turned out that my brother had married bigamously. So his marriage to Elizabeth Woodville was invalid because he was actually already married to Eleanor Butler. Well, that was quite a shock, I can tell you. And what it meant was both his sons were illegitimate, so therefore I was next in line to the throne, and so I did my duty and took over as king. I mean, what else could I do? I mean, the citizens of London, both common and noble, had drawn up a petition asking me to take the position. So, you know, that's the way it goes, isn't it? Third, what happened to the princes? Oh, well, you'll have heard that they were murdered in the Tower of London, but there's no evidence for that at all. It's certainly not true, no. They did disappear, but just into that seclusion. Honest. So the question for you really is that did I, as some will say, kill my brother, kill his sons, poison my wife and drown my brother, George Duke of Clarence, in a vat of Malmsey wine, and go on about giving my kingdom for a horse? Or was that all down to my descendants, or the people who took over, successors, the Tudors, who had no more right to rule than a dog, let's be honest, and particularly that idiot Sir Thomas More and that playwright Shaky Spear chap, making up an evil history. That's what they were doing, you know, in order to make their masters seem more legitimate kings, which clearly they weren't. Well, I shall leave that up to you. But, yeah, I mean, I keep a picture of the twins with me all times. Their little face, little faces, aren't they beautiful? Yes. I shall leave it to you.
Margaret of Anjou. They call me She-Wolf, because I am brave and ferocious, unlike my snivelling husband, Henry VI. I married him on the 23rd of June, 1445. The marriage had been arranged by William Delapole, who was part of the Lancastrian party in the Wars of the Roses. It ensured the House of York would not find a bride for Henry. My marriage was also part of the Truce of Tours, which gave Anjou back to France, providing peace between England and France, temporarily suspending the fighting, which later became known as the Hundred Years' War. Can you guess how long it went on for? In short, I was married to try and stop a few wars. Little did they know. I was crowned at Westminster Abbey and I never looked back. Power is my middle name, and I would take it. In 1453, Henry was taken ill with a bout of insanity. In short, he went mad. He heard voices and saw things. Pixies and fairies, he even thought he was made of glass. In the meantime, I gave birth to a son, Edward. This set the cat amongst the pigeons. Because the bloke who thought he would get the throne after Henry died now wouldn't. It would go to my son. But tongues will wag, and the enemy, the Yorkists, came up with some silly story that Henry was unable to father a child, and I must have had Edward with another man, meaning he was illegitimate, and therefore he had no right to the throne. Even off his rockers, Henry believed it too, for a while. But young Edward was always at my side. He shared my thirst for power and a desire to rule England. What a king he would have been! He was only a baby when the Duke of York took steps to try to become king in his place. What was I to do? Who would defend him? His father was not around, so I decided I would become father to the young prince and protect him as best I could. Then, miracle of miracles, his father suddenly came back to his senses, or rather I knocked them into him, and he knew that he was Edward's daddy after all. Henry was still weak and feeble, though, so I did all the ruling for a bit, and I fought some rather good battles. The first great battle was at Blore Heath. I was there, but being a weak and feeble woman, I was not allowed to fight. The sight of those two great armies was fantastic. To know that one of them would move and do what I said at my bidding, I'd created an animal with teeth and claws that would move at my command and kill my enemies asunder. I was so excited by that battle, I climbed the church tower to get a better view. But we lost, and in my finery, I had to escape. Now, the enemy had captured my husband, so I got together a huge army of 15,000 men. That's quite a lot of them, especially when they're armed to the teeth with swords and spikes and sharp, pointy things. And they were a bit miffed that their king had been captured. Some of the enemies went outside the castle they were hiding in, and my army got them, good and proper. And to make things even better, the Duke of York, the man who thought he would be king instead of my son, was killed. His head was chopped off and brought to me as proof. Also, to make things even better, his snivelling son was also killed whilst trying to escape. That'll teach him. This is why we don't go into battle. Our hennins constantly fall off. Anyway, I decided I would teach them a lesson once and for all. And I had a bit of a chat with what was left as Richard. His head was brought to me on a spike. My enemy is dead and gone. Where are your nasty words now, York? Indeed, where is your body? I shall crown you at last. Ah, you do look splendid. It's nice up here on the castle walls, is it not? Here you can see the whole family that gave you and your family its name. The people of York will remember you forever, I am sure. But I will let you look on them a while longer, till your rotten eyes fall from your head anyway, and then you should rest your tired head. But I didn't want him to lose his crown. It's windy up there on Micklegate Bar. So I nailed the paper crown to his head and left him for all to see. Next came the bloodiest battle ever fought on English soil. The Battle of Towton, Palm Sunday, 1461. The snow whipped up, driving full into the face of my army. This made their attempts to return arrow fire laughable, and the enemy's archers inflicted great damage upon my men. In terrible hand-to-hand combat that lasted all day as we pushed our foe back, yard by bloody yard. The bodies piled up in the freezing cold, and the troops had to climb over corpses to reach the front lines. Finally, they could take no more. They broke and ran, trying to cross Cock Beck, the bodies of armoured men providing a bridge for them. At least as many died in the panic of that rout as died on the battlefield. And in total, they think 28,000 men or even more lost their lives. Towton was by far the bloodiest battle in the Wars of the Roses. 10 years later, in 1471, me and my son were taken prisoner. He was murdered by the Yorkists, and my husband died in the Tower of London, no doubt murdered. I was imprisoned in England for 5 years. But in 1476, the King of France paid a ransom to England for me, and I was returned to France, living in poverty, till I died in Anjou in 1482. A measly death for a mighty queen. But if you asked me, why, I'd do the whole thing again.
How do? I'm George Pym, educator, notorious spendthrift, and cold-blooded child catcher. I was headmaster at the ragged school at Bedern Hall, Yorkshire, and it truly was the school of hard knocks. Mostly because all the children died before graduating, and I ended up stuffing them in a cupboard. But more on that later. As you'll see, there are more than just skeletons lurking in my closet. In the mid-1800s, in the Bedern area of York, it was totally impoverished, full of slum housing and infested with street urchins. Rotten little creatures. Clogging up good gutters were a shambles. So in the mid-1800s, they opened up the York Industrial Ragged School to get these urchins off the street. The governors put me in charge. Me, Mr. Bim. I was paid per child, which meant the more children I caught, the more... enrolled. The more children I enrolled, the more money I would make, see? I became a sort of York child catcher. But I didn't just have to teach them. No, I had to feed and clothe them as well. And let me tell you, they are an ungrateful bunch, children. Always asking to be fed daily. Not a chance. The less clothes and food I provided, the more money I would make for myself. And there's nought in the universe as tight as a Yorkshireman's fist. As children do, though, they began to die in their droves. But I still collected the money, of course. Naturally, I didn't want a big fuss with funerals and the like, so I stored the bodies neatly and compactly in a cupboard. A book cupboard. Kids make for excellent bookends. But wouldn't they begin to smell? I hear a voice in the back of my mind ask. Not a problem. It was the winter. The ground was frozen solid, so I couldn't have buried them if I tried. I suppose they did begin to rot in the spring. Yes. And that's when I buried them in shallow graves. I would have gotten away with it too, if it wasn't for those meddling kids. They started screaming. Not the ones that survived. No. The dead ones. I could hear them. The little brats. Wincing. In the cupboard. And when I went near, they'd scream. All of them would scream. I couldn't stand it. So that's when I took a knife to the others. And that's when they caught me. The living scream louder than the dead. They said I was mad. Me, mad! They locked me up here in this institution. I run an institution. I am a teacher. A peer of the community. All I did was try to get children off the streets. It's a teacher's job. Believe you me, I did it well. Some people say my story is a fiction, passed down by superstitious mothers to encourage their children to finish their ready break. Others say I was hanged. But the ragged school did close down. And for a while, it was a pork pie factory. Makes you wonder what rent meat, don't it? But don't worry though. School's out now. Forever.
Horrid history, eh? Amateurs. My name is William of Normandy, Duke of Normandy and King of England. I was horrid all my life. I had to be. When I was young, you see, my father was Duke of Normandy, but my mother was not the Duchess, so I had to fight for my inheritance, horridly, which I did, and won. Then Edward the Confessor, King of England, said that I could be King of England when he died, but on his deathbed, he changed his mind, and instead he said that Harold Godwinson, a Saxon Earl, could be King instead. Harold had already promised me that he would help me be King of England. And I was horridly angry. I crossed the sea with a great fleet and army and had Harold horridly hacked to death at Hastings. I was then crowned King of England at Westminster Abbey on Christmas Day 1066. But the English decided they didn't want me for their king. Perhaps I was too horrid. Well, they rose up in revolt in 1069. In the south and the west, a wild Saxon warrior by the name of Edric the Wild went wild in the west. And in the north, the Vikings, the old enemies of the Saxons, were called to help their old foes. They attacked the city of York. My Norman garrison bravely burnt the town down and then marched out of the castle walls to take on the Vikings in the open field. Alas, they were massacred to a man, and the Saxons held great feasts for the Vikings, their former enemies. So, I march north to deal with the nuisance in an episode of history that has become known as the Harrying of the North. I didn't just want to win, I wanted to crush the people of the north of England so that they never rose up again. Houses were burned, animals were slaughtered so the people went hungry, crops were burned and their fields sown with salt so that nothing more would grow afterwards. Every Saxon male that my forces encountered was put to death, and along the roads of the north of England, huge piles of bodies began to pile up, and the people were so hungry that they started to eat the corpses to stay alive. Pretty horrid. Even by the standards of those times. In fact, one of my chroniclers, a fellow named Odric Potatus, who was normally very nice to me, thought I'd gone too far. He wrote this: "To his shame, William made no effort to control his fury, punishing the innocent. He ordered the crops and herds and tools to be burned to ashes. More than 100,000 people perished of hunger. I have often praised William in this book, but I can say nothing good about the brutal slaughter. God will punish him." Whatever, Odric. After 20 years, I did start to feel a bit bad about what happened in the north of England, but not bad enough to do anything about it. But on my deathbed, I did confess to this. I persecuted the native inhabitants of England beyond all reason. Whether nobles or commoners, I cruelly oppressed them. Many I unjustly disinherited. Innumerable multitudes, especially in the county of York, perished through fire and famine and sword. And I am stained with the rivers of blood that I have shed. Horrid. After the harrying of the north, my Norman followers built motte and bailey castles up and down the land to control the populace. We Normans were very good at building castles, and you can still see some of them in the north of England today, or at least the improvements that were made afterwards. And even at my funeral, that was pretty horrid as well. My coffin was lined with lead, and my body began to rot inside. And as the noxious gases built up, at my funeral, the coffin burst, billowing forth a very, very horrid smell indeed. So much so that the priest who was doing the service rushed through to get it over with. Horrid in life, horrid in death, I am your horrid history champion. So, vote for me, otherwise you know what will happen. Yes, something horrid. He knows which side his bread's buttered, don't you? William of Normandy, out.
The most horrid person in history? Me? Perhaps I am. Allow me to introduce myself. I am Elizabeth Bathory. Or perhaps you know me as the Blood Countess. I may be the most horrid person in history, that is for you to judge. I'll tell you my story. I was born in 1560 in Hungary to one of the wealthiest and most prominent families. Of course, with that, I was married at the age of 14. 4,500 people were at my wedding, and I was gifted a castle and many villages by my husband, the Black Knight. It is there that I began my supposed reign of terror, with my husband, who educated me in ways to discipline our servants. The lady of my standing, of course, has many servants, and I liked them to maintain good discipline. If perhaps one of my young ladies would miss a stitch on their needlework, I would just tell them to unpick and do the work again. And I'd chop the finger off. If they had the gall to misbehave further, I might wrap up little pieces of paper, soak them in oil, place them between their fingers and toes, and set light to them. If they would maintain their bad behaviour, I may even throw them over the walls, be ripped apart by wolves. My reign carried on until well after my husband's death. But in 1610, I was arrested. I was put on secret trial, and I was imprisoned. Was I the vicious, horrific Blood Countess that they accused me of, allegedly murdering up to 650 victims? 306 people spoke at my trial against me. It was said that as they stormed my castle, they found dying and dead, rotting corpses, a homemade cemetery in the middle of my castle for my victims. Did I bury them alive? Did I torture them? Or perhaps I was wrongly accused. Well, there is another story that says perhaps as a powerful widow, a woman running her own castle and lands, who the King of Hungary owed a great debt, it was more convenient to remove me and claim the castle and lands for their own. Whatever the story, whatever the truth, my name has gone down in legend. The Blood Countess, the vampire, the woman who bathed in the blood of her victims to maintain her youth and beauty. Was I the most horrid person in history? In 1614, in my cell, I complained one night of cold hands. My jailer told me to lay down and go to sleep. That sleep, I never awoke from. What did I do? Maybe I'll come and visit you in your nightmares.
Thanks for joining us. If you have enjoyed this event as part of the Harrogate International Festivals, please do think about a donation to ensure that our festivals can survive in the future. Donations can be made by texting HIF and the amount to 70085. For more events, please visit our online hub, the HIF Player. It's packed with upcoming live streams, events you've missed, archive recordings, and much more.